Well, this kind of leads on to the next bit, which is streams linked to... So streaming platforms now are sort of leaned on quite heavily. You have to have a numerous amount of streams to make it or to have your song pop. So now you tend to see artists make songs that are made for TikTok. So that it can be played on TikTok, and then that gets played again and again and again. And people are like, what's that earworm? And then eventually you go on Spotify and you listen to it. Growth hack. Problem is that some artists now, there was a little bit of an issue with that recently. So black TikTokers got pissed off on TikTok because their dances were getting nicked by others. Goran, I'll give you like a bit of a brief here. So on TikTok, it's all about like different trends on there. You can do numerous things, but the most common one is dancing. And a lot of black TikTokers were making these really viral dances. People with a higher following who weren't black were then copying it, using it themselves, and then getting money endorsements off that, and then allowing it to pop even more. So what black TikTokers did was they said, we're not going to do it for any more songs. So who was it? Megan Thee Stallion? She had a new song come out, and it only did like 22 million streams, which, you know, isn't much apparently. But she was upset with that small number because normally it would have been bigger because there was no one to make a dance and there was no one to make a song for them. There was no one to make a dance for them that was going to be viral enough for other people to copy. Prime example of this is a girl called Addison Rae. She's a famous girl on TikTok. She went on Jimmy Fallon, performed the dance. Then other people who watched the show or people who were really famous copied it and then used that forward. But she didn't make that dance. It was made by another girl. And that other girl was called, what was her name? Jalia, I think it is. She made it and she said she didn't get credit for it. And if you don't get credit for it, again, it goes back to the similar topic like we just had, which is about not getting credit and then getting screwed over for it. She didn't get the endorsement money. Her idea got jacked and it's plagiarism. That's it.
If you own the IP.
Yeah. But how can you own an IP of a dance? So it's sort of like It's a really, really great area.
Comes down to morals in there. If you have the right morals, you wouldn't do it anyway. But if you don't, you're ruthless and you just had to make your pee, then that's what you do, man. But it's not sustainable. That's the thing, you know? Like, if you can't come up with this stuff, eventually...
Is it. And this is why I think there's a whole hoo-ha on TikTok is where black creators were like, okay, we're not going to create now.
What are you going to do?
Exactly.
I blame them. I'd do the same thing. I'm like, yo, fuck it, man. Exactly. I don't want to do this anymore. Like, what's the point? Seems like bollocks, because if we're just going to end up getting shafted for it afterwards.
Rick, what do you think about OnlyFans?
I think OnlyFans is another great thing that internet has given us. The ability to make money direct to consumer. And cutting out the middleman. I like what it has done in terms of opening that opportunity out into other things other than what OnlyFans is typically known for.
The connotation. But those people, man, like every, you know, you're scrolling on Facebook, right, and you'll get this thing about ex-policewoman now makes £10,000 a month.
It's ridiculous.
Like, right? And you're just like...
Bro, you need to start reading the Daily Mail, man.
Yeah, it's always the Daily Mail. But it's like, I look at that because I'm trying to understand the metric. I'm like, okay, fine. Because I did a bit of research myself. And again, my connotation was... I was like, OnlyFans is for this. And then I looked at the actual About Us and what it's actually for. And it's like, no, this is for creators and people who want to produce content. I was like, it's really far from that. But then I looked to see if there are any doctors in that space. There's only one or two. So I'm toying with the idea of putting some stuff out there just to see...
So there's Patreon. Patreon's really like good. That's like another version of OnlyFans, but it doesn't have the same connotation. Yeah, exactly. it's a little bit more. I'm providing you something. I'm providing you a service, knowledge, or whatever, and you're going to pay for the access of that. Which is, like I said, it really just opens up streams of income that just weren't available to us in the past, and I think because the world is so local now, you're bound to find someone who's interested in your ideas, in your talent, in what you can give, in what you can share, and who's willing to purchase that and make payments.
And conversion, man. I mean, I think, although you talk about, you know, like 500 and things like that. So as an example, Eric, I'm doing something now. I'm working with a YouTuber, 2 million subscribers, right? So we're doing like a co-thing, and he's going to drop a video positioning what I do in the next coming month. If we, I mean, if I can put 1% of his subscribers, man, like that's just...
Well, this is it. This is it.
Do you know what I mean? Like, and you're right, the world is big, but once people have access, then it's like, finding your people, your niche, and then just, I mean, Patreon stuff. My sister listens to a lot of podcasts, and she'll do some Patreon stuff on there. And the increments, like, they're not stupid, man. They're like £1, £3, £5. They're
reasonable. Yeah,
yeah, exactly. Right?
And Indy, you showed me a podcast recently.
Flavor 2, yeah.
What's their monthly income?
About 25K, I think it is.
Right, and it's, so they've got the number of users. It's really transparent, isn't it? Patreon will say you have this many.
Yeah, it tells you how many users you have, how many
at this level. And you're like, this isn't that unachievable. I look at that and I get inspired and I think, okay, there's this many people paying like £1 or £2. I said India, I was like, we can do that.
It easily adds up. It really does add up. And like you said, because the world is so local now, you're playing in such a big field. So you're not looking for, you're not just trying to find 500 people in Birmingham and everyone else is competing in the Birmingham space. Actually, you're worldwide and there's going to be billions of people that are going to resonate with whatever you're saying, doing, giving, and it's an amazing opportunity. It's such an amazing opportunity.